Well, hello everybody. So I'm Matthias Ortner. I'm from Airbus Defence and Space. So most of you probably know Airbus. It's not a startup. I might be the least startup-ish guy here. I'm 40 years old. I want to talk today about a few things we learned on our path while trying to apply deep learning technologies for satellite imagery. So basically, in Airbus, I'm in the branch that builds satellites and rockets, and we also sell satellite images. So here is the context, and I really want to present two key elements that might be useful for people starting using deep learning technologies in their own domain. So first of all, those are samples of the Earth as seen from space. And the thing is, our images are typically 40,000 pixels wide and 400,000 pixels high, which makes them not the average image you can meet on Earth. And you have lots of them. So there is a need for automated monitoring and automated analysis of what's inside these images. And we really want to bring these analysis tools in production. So I just want to start with something. We have to build our own models. We cannot do transfer learning because those images are very different from what you are used to on the public web. As you might expect, there's no gravity from space, and all objects are rotated all around. We cannot say a tree is a tree because we have some green area on the top and some brown area on the bottom. Everything can be mixed up. So about the context, first of all, have we seen deep learning algorithms are achieving excellent performances? I've been working in the field for 15 years, and for the last 5 years, we've seen a huge increase in performances and in the delay between a technology and its usage in production. So just some elements here, you can see some examples of topics on which we achieve above human performances using deep learning perception. Now, another important thing, I think, is the fact that since I graduated my PhD, computational cost has dropped by a factor 10,000. It's a lot. So there's no reason for me to use a technology than 15 years ago. I really need to leverage on the power that is available now. And I will show you how we use this power. And still about the context, those are my best friends. I use them every day. I use Docker every way. I use Stack Overflow every day. Cloud machine learning and cloud, Google Cloud Platform every day. I use clusters of computers. I use GitLab for continuous integration. I use TensorFlow as a deep learning tool. You might use other tools, but just to give you a landscape of the tools we've been using so far. We use Apache Spark, Python, and Git. So we have all of this framework and all of these tools. We are using them for a reason. It's because we need to go to production. And that's really important. And now, what for? I want to show you only three applications we've been working on. And I'm sorry, it's very simple applications. I mean, I'm not a top-level scientific guy. I'm not working in a startup. It's just some simple applications on image satellite images. So it might look simple, but for us, those are big steps. So the first one is cloud detection. Every morning, we receive thousands of images from our satellites, and we need to know if the image is worth selling or not. And that means if you can see the image or not. And basically, it means, do we have clouds within images? This is a very old topic. We've been working on that for 30 years, or 20 years, and it's a hard one, as you can see on this image. You have some areas where it's very hard to distinguish between clouds and snow. Using deep learning, we achieved a very huge increase of performance by dividing the error rate by a factor of 4 between the current state of the art and what we obtain. So this is the first example. Second one is to improve the quality of images. If I want to sell a cheap satellite to a foreign country, for instance, I may want to have not that good images on board, but then on ground, process the image and improve the performance of the image. So this is a topic which is called denoising. So here on this example, I stretch the contrast so you can see here in the room what's happening. And maybe you can see that we remove some pixel noise in the image. And what's really interesting here, it's a topic that would usually require a full PhD or even two PhD working on that before we get a result. And using deep learning technology, we were able to get a result in 2 months. And I really think this is a key about deep learning. It's not only about having good performances, it's about shrinking the time to market between an idea and the production. And the final example I wanted to show you here, before going on some other topics, it's how to go from image to information. So here I'm presenting just two cases. First of all, instead of selling images, we could sell the number of aircrafts within an airport, or even better, the evolution of the number of aircrafts on some areas of the world. Or we could imagine selling semantic information about a specific area, for instance, about forest decreasing or stuff like that. For these topics, we also use deep learning. So now that I've presented you the applications, I want to show you some developer stuff that might be interesting. And first of all, I want to show you this because this is my day-to-day job. I'm not writing algorithms anymore. I'm growing up algorithms, and this is a huge difference. It means every day I have clusters of computers that perform training and provide me with some new algorithms. So what I have actually, so it's an algorithm farm. I'm growing up algorithm. And we now have a team of people doing that every day. And when it comes to this, the first question is, what about version control? One of our best friends is Git, or SVN, or well, whatever you want. But you need to version algorithms. So what does it mean when you talk about deep learning? So as I said, I'm a 40 years old guy. It means when I was young, the geeky thing to do was to code in assembly. So I did a lot of assembly in my young life. So well, when you build a program or an algorithm in that type of language, you just stack some elementary operations like comparison, multiplication, plus you apply some function or some linear operation. Deep learning is just about this, but instead of putting these operations together by yourself, you ask for a computer to do it, and you structure it in a fashion that the computer can learn how to adapt and how to sequence these elements. So now, if you think about it, what does a training mean? And I really just want to show you what's the process of training. Because what you need to get in the end is those set of coefficients, alpha and beta here. And this will be really the core of your algorithm. So it all starts with training data, like this. You start with the first version of your algorithm, maybe you initiate it by random, structure in some fashion, and you get a result which you can compare with your training data. And you say, OK, I have a loss function that tells me how far I am from my desired output, which allow me, in turn, to make some updates. So I have an updating scheme that acts on my alpha and betas. And I iterate, 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 and in the end, I get some alphas and betas that fits my needs. Now, once I have my structure, my alphas and betas, I can use the algorithm. But there is a difference in nature between the two elements. On one hand, I have a structure which I can describe using text files. On the other hand, I have some binary data, basically the coefficients of my program or my algorithm. And the only thing I can do basically, the only thing I can do is just tag, okay, I just performed the learning, I can tag it, it's version 0.1, maybe I will do a training later, it will be the version 0.2. But if you think about it, what you really need to control is the full training context. And this is very important for you if you want to perform some training on your own. You need to keep track of the set of data you've been using for training. You need to keep track of the structure of the algorithm you're building, the loss function, and the update mechanism. Because basically, what the training is a kind of stochastic compilation. You're going from set of text files, Python files, or whatever, to describe the full configuration. You perform a training, and then in the end, you obtain a binary set of coefficients. And we really think of it like this. And so we make a difference between the final binary model, which is not that important, and all the information that is required to perform a training. And if you want to start using deep learning, you really should think of this ahead of everything else. How will I keep track of all my trainings? Because it allows me, for instance, just to change the updating scheme and to make some merges or some forks like we are used to when designing usual programs. And this is very important. This is very important for us. Why? Because I'm not training only one configuration. As I said, every day I'm training tens, thousands of configurations because I need to see which structure is the best. And this is what I think deep learning is really about. It provides you with the ability to describe a context for generating algorithms. And which context is the best is very hard to know in advance. For instance, in my experience, the learning rate of the optimizing scheme is the first parameter to explore. And so you need to keep track and to perform some genetic selection of what's the best context for your specific problem. So as I said, well, I use natural selection, for my algorithm. So I cut the plants that are not good, and I keep the best one every day. It's kind of sad. And so what we use actually, we use Git, but we use Git with some factory tool that builds all the context from a YAML file. It's very simple. And it allows us to work together. I have one of my friends who is working on the optimizing scheme, another friend that is working on the loss function, and we can merge. This is very important because you will meet a lot of people doing training or deep learning, but just in their own world, not as a team. So there is a huge question here, how to use this control version, because I need to go to production, and I need to keep track of how I get a specific algorithm. Another question I wanted to present you, because it's also of importance if you start using deep learning, is the need for data exploration and continuous learning. So what does it mean? In that specific example, I'm looking for aircraft, but not only in one place, in many places of the world. So just going back, just have a look. You have this huge area on only a few aircrafts, but here I spotted airports. But if you think about it, there's no reason just to look at an airport by random. So there's something going on here. There's something. I want to find an aircraft, and it's a very rare event in the set of in all my data. So you can see it on this image. This is the Earth by night. You can see urban areas are only a small set of areas over the Earth, which means that if you start with some data for performing a training, so here I put some aircraft example on the bottom, some non-aircraft example on top, and I say, okay, algorithm, please start learning, and then at the end I get 1,000 of algorithms that learned how to discriminate between these images, and most of them will fail on real data. Why is that? Because on the top row, I selected example by random on the Earth. If I take example by random, I get sea, forest, desert, which are not the key elements I should be looking at for building a very good algorithm. Here are some other examples I got after a while after interacting with my data. You can see on the top row, I have non-aircraft examples that look like aircraft. You can see crossroads, you can see elements that could be compared to aircraft. And this is very interesting because there is no way I could find these elements before trying to learn and trying to interact with my data. So it means I need learning first, learning again and learning again before I can find these elements. And it's very similar on the bottom row, where you can see I have aircrafts, well, they are parked in some weird fashion just to optimize the room. So it's not the canonical type of aircraft you would think of if you start the process of learning. So the conclusion for this picture is quite simple. It means you need a loop with some detection, some review, in order to build a new data set that will contain more of these confused elements, and then perform a new training. And what is most interesting is very probably you will have to keep on doing that all along. It means there's no final model when you go into production. You will need to have continuous integration and continuous learning all around the path. So that's why you really need a version control tool. You really need a data interaction tool so you can spot good elements and bad elements. And you need to have this continuous learning stack around. So those are just two main conclusions or three main conclusions I wanted to present you. And as I said, well, we are open. We have many more applications we are investigating. And just to let you know, we are located in Toulouse in France, which is nice. And still looking for people if some of you want to join us. Thank you very much.